You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.
...1988, a year of conciliation between the United States and the Soviet Union, a year of transition in American politics, and a year when the volatility of terrorism strikes home again. Throughout the year, the United States and the Soviet Union continue to broker their differences as the steady thaw in the Cold War progresses. The main reason for this movement is because of this man, Mikhail Gorbachev, and the revolutionary changes he is masterminding in the Kremlin, reversing the direction of over 70 years of Soviet policy. In one of several surprise announcements made during the year, the Soviets declare in January that they are putting an end to their 8-year war in neighboring Afghanistan. During the 80s, the Soviets shuttled over a million soldiers in and out of Afghanistan, trying to secure a friendly communist regime. But their forces were stalemated by fierce resistance from Afghan guerrilla freedom fighters, the Mujahideen, who were supplied with over $2 billion worth of U.S. arms through rebel bases in Pakistan. The military occupation compromised Soviet foreign policy and became intensely unpopular at home. As soldiers died by the thousands, in Moscow, protest against the war came to resemble protests in the US against the Vietnam War. Now proclaiming the incursion a bleeding wound, Gorbachev calls for the withdrawal of over 100,000 Soviet troops in 1988.
Remember this, these negotiations have been going on for 5.5 years.
Meeting in Geneva in April to formalize the United Nations-sponsored peace treaty, Afghanistan, Pakistan, the United States, and the Soviet Union all sign the accord. In the end, the Afghan adventure is considered a total failure for the Soviets and a tragedy for Afghanistan, which retains its independence at the cost of a million lives. Now, trying to reduce the threat of future war on a global scale, Gorbachev extends an olive branch of friendship to Ronald Reagan in May, when the two leaders meet in Moscow for their fourth summit. The meeting extends the spirit of cooperation established at previous summits and is marked by cordiality and symbolism, but not a great deal of substance.
Do you still think you're in an evil empire, Mr. President?
I was talking about another time and another era.
Important issues such as the reduction of long-range nuclear missiles are left to foreign secretaries. At the same time, Reagan presses Gorbachev on human rights violations and then meets with Soviet dissidents, artists, and church leaders.
Just fine, and everyone is made to feel very welcome.
Stealing a page from Gorbachev's script at the Washington summit, Reagan takes to the streets to meet Muscovites face to face.
Turn around this way, sir. Hey.
While their private talks are sometimes tough, in public, the leaders put on remarkably warm faces.
We share that view. We want friendship between our two peoples.
I think you understand, we're not just grateful to both you and Mrs. Gorbachev, but want you to know we think of you as friends.
But a Cold War of another kind appears to be escalating between First Ladies Nancy Reagan and Raisa Gorbachev. Not known to be close friends, their public appearances now show real signs of strain.
Yeah, I want to say something.
I want to say something.
Okay?
On the last day of the summit, Reagan and Gorbachev signed the recently ratified Intermediate Range Nuclear Force, or INF, treaty, limiting the number of lethal missiles in Europe. But the real accomplishment of the Moscow meeting is the firm establishment of goodwill and the continuing dialogue over the future of superpower relations.
Our way here has not been easy. At crucial moments, your personal intervention was needed and proved decisive, and for this we are grateful.
Each such meeting dealt a blow at the foundations of the Cold War.
Gorbachev stuns the outside world with his foreign policy initiatives, but his programs for reform at home, glasnost and perestroika, have raised expectations that can't possibly be met in the near future.
What is happening now, of course, is that Gorbachev is trying to make the institutional changes that are necessary, but they are slow in coming. And because they're so slow in coming, he needs lots of time. But the question is, are Soviet people going to be patient enough? They have been patient now for 3.5 years. They expected some improvement. They've gotten nothing except a deterioration in conditions.
Internal dissent is mounting. Now Gorbachev has to contend with angry revolts within several of the 15 republics that make up the Soviet Union. In the south, Christian Armenians and Muslims in Azerbaijan battle throughout the year over territorial rights in their ancient homelands. In the Baltics, the states of Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia, annexed by the Soviets during World War II, are now pushing hard for independence, and the weakened Soviet Union is facing disintegration. Despite the growing troubles, Gorbachev continues to consolidate his power base when he revamps the Supreme Soviet to make it more representative. He also engineers his own election as president of the Soviet Union, a position that affords him greater responsibilities and challenges. Transition is the hallmark of the political process in the United States in 1988. In this last year of the Reagan presidency, 13 hopeful successors join the electoral fray, and as the year begins, there are no clear frontrunners in either party. Vice President George Bush is one of 6 Republicans running the gauntlet of the primaries. But there are troubles in the Bush campaign. Since he had served Reagan faithfully, the vice president cannot divorce himself from many of the problems that arose in Reagan's era, most notably the Iran-Contra scandal.
What did George Bush know about Iran? That isn't a compelling issue.
And his past relationship with Panamanian strongman Manuel Noriega, who is being investigated for international drug trafficking.
But that is not what's going to determine the election. What is?
He made all those decisions in the CIA. What were they? Was Noriega on the payroll when he was CIA director?
All the issues, combined with what the media labels the wimp factor, create the image that Bush is a weak candidate. Former Secretary of State Alexander Haig and TV evangelist Pat Robertson are among his rivals. But the strongest challenge comes from Senate Minority Leader Robert Dole of Kansas.
But I believe I'm a stronger candidate and that I'm more electable.
On the Democratic side, there is no clear leader. Gary Hart, who has re-entered the race despite the scandal over his relationship with model Donna Rice in 1987, finds his campaign in shambles.
It's a rocky road uphill.
Keep a big smile on your face.
Trying to, yeah.
The only other candidate with national recognition is the Reverend Jesse Jackson, who built a solid support base in 1984. A pack of relative unknowns joins the race. Bruce Babbitt of Arizona, Paul Simon of Illinois, Richard Gephardt of Missouri, Al Gore of Tennessee, and Michael Dukakis of Massachusetts. The horse race begins in the states of Iowa and New Hampshire, and the candidates campaign intensely there, hoping that early wins will give their campaigns some momentum. Gephardt wins the Iowa caucuses for the Democrats. Dole wins on the Republican side, and Vice President Bush finishes third behind Pat Robertson.
But I've discovered I have something, another something in common with President Reagan. We both lost Iowa.
Here in New Hampshire also.
Then on to New Hampshire, historically the first primary which defines frontrunners for the nomination. Bush gets his badly needed win in New Hampshire for the Republicans, and Governor Michael Dukakis of neighboring Massachusetts springs from the Democratic pack to claim this prize. On March 8, 20 states hold primaries and caucuses. This day becomes known as Super Tuesday, and it will significantly narrow the field. Negative campaigns set the tone in this political year, with candidates playing on their opponents' weaknesses.
Bob Dole will make a difference for America.
Positive ads like this one by Richard Gephardt.
How many Americans are going to pay $48,000 for one of their Hyundais?
Are drowned out by an ad depicting him as a legislative gymnast.
Gephardt has flip-flopped on a lot of issues.
Of all the candidates, Jesse Jackson manages to stay above the mudslinging. When the Super Tuesday delegates to the Democratic National Convention are counted, only the Dukakis, Gore, and Jackson campaigns have survived to see Wednesday. On the Republican side, George Bush defies conventional wisdom and virtually wraps up the Republican nomination. This gives him months to quietly begin laying the groundwork for his presidential campaign against the Democratic nominee. The New York primary in April would be decisive for the Democrats, who are stumping hard on some social issues that plague the nation: homelessness, education, and drugs. This ad by movie director Spike Lee drives home one of Jackson's themes.
We the people can win this war on drugs.
Jackson makes a strong showing with urban voters, but Dukakis claims most of the delegates in New York State. Michael Dukakis has now pulled way ahead of the pack of Democrats, and the nomination is almost out of anyone else's reach. But Jesse Jackson has become a major player in the party, and his supporters express the hope that he will be the first African-American vice president.
I think Jesse Jackson, if he is in second place, should be given consideration.
At a political dinner in June, the victorious candidates sit side by side. It's the first time since 1968 that an incumbent president is not running. The primaries are calling attention to a number of the nation's social problems, which seem to be getting worse. Overall, drug use in the U.S. is declining. But during the 80s, the number of Americans abusing cocaine has skyrocketed. In the early part of the decade, this white powder was considered a white-collar drug. Coke was it. Coke was chic. And at $100 a gram, it had the high price tag to match. Like more conventional status symbols, cocaine had become another sign of ambition and prosperity.
Cocaine has a unique ability to stimulate the brain's reward centers, to become just as important to the chronic user as food, water, sex, money, family, job, career.
The myth that cocaine is glamorous and safe to use is shattered when it kills 22-year-old Len Bias in 1986. Bias embodied the American dream. A starting forward for the University of Maryland basketball team, he was the Boston Celtics' number one draft pick. His death shocks the nation. America learns that cocaine can kill.
Money, money, money!
Cocaine is big business. Americans are spending over $30 billion a year on it. Both suppliers and users are a formidable adversary in the war on drugs. Trying to help out, Nancy Reagan embarks on her own anti-drug campaign.
And to all of you children, thank you for coming. And if you're ever offered drugs, please, please, just say no so loud that everyone around you can hear. And if you do that, drugs won't stand a chance.
But by 1988, America is besieged by an even graver threat than cocaine. Crack, a concentrated and cheap cocaine derivative, has hit the streets. This smokable drug is even more addictive than cocaine. Because of its low price, crack permeates the country, especially the inner cities, claiming a new class of addicts who say that once they tried it, they couldn't just say no.
Crack is the hardest thing for me to walk away from.
First hit was instant addiction.
You want more, and if you don't have the money, you go out stealing, or you'll kill. You do anything for it. I mean anything.
Crack use is growing out of control.
Crack hotline operator 191, may I help you?
Neither drug treatment programs nor law enforcement agencies can begin to meet the new demands imposed by crack. Another social ill which mushrooms during the decade is homelessness. Not since the Great Depression have street dwellers been more visible. In 1988, Charles Boucher, the head of the nation's General Accounting Office, puts the plight of the homeless on his list of problems most neglected by the Reagan administration. He estimates that 3 million Americans do not have a permanent place to live.
Oh, well, I'm just a victim of gentrification, and you could kind of like say I was gentrified.
This woman recalls the experience of living out on the streets.
Any mother, anyone who has children knows what it's like to be hungry at some point in time. And to see your baby sitting there hungry, and you know they're hungry, you don't even have a way to get them a drink of water, much less wash them up. It's terrible.
Thousands of families with children have no homes. The problem is not confined to the inner cities.
I think when people in this country think of homeless, they think of the bag ladies, they think of people sleeping on grates in the big cities, and don't realize the impact that the housing cuts and the lack of assistance in the rural areas is having on people.
But there are no easy solutions. While the number of homeless continues to rise, the supply of low-income housing in the U.S. is actually shrinking. Many shelters for the homeless are overcrowded and unsafe.
Generally, the shelters are good. The people try to help you, but you get killed getting in one.
The GAO advises that Washington allocate $20 billion to repair public housing. But the federal government is largely passing this responsibility to the states and cities, which are already financially strained and unable to stem the flow of more homeless people on their streets.
The holes that the wells are in seem to be getting smaller daily, and so it doesn't look very good for the wells.
But big money and a big effort go to freeing Earth's largest mammal in October when two California gray whales are found stuck under ice in Barrow, Alaska.
They should have been heading back south, and they shouldn't have been coming up this way. And there's just no telling why. We've had heavy, heavy ice concentrations in the general area, and I suspect maybe they could have got trapped in a lead.
Soviets, Americans, and others band together in an international effort to free the whales.
Lots of hope, strictly hope, and desire to get it done. I mean, there's nothing, we're just going on a wing and a prayer. It's all we're going on.
The aim is to create a series of holes so that they can move away from this area.
After 3 weeks, the whales make it to open sea.
How are you dressed? What's that supposed to mean? It means where you dressed.
1988's box office hits propel some familiar actors to new heights of critical acclaim. Jodie Foster comes of age and wins the Best Actress Award for her portrayal of a rape victim in The Accused.
What the hell are you talking about? You saw me at the hospital. What do you think I asked for that? Is that what you think?
Tom Cruise also receives high praise when he comes to know his autistic brother, played by Dustin Hoffman, in Rain Man, which receives 4 Oscars, including Best Picture.
Pepper, baby.
No, I'm sure you're a real...
Audiences cheer on Melanie Griffith as she tries to win the big contract and Harrison Ford's heart in Working Girl.
I have a head for business and a bod for sin. Is there anything wrong with that?
You should know about it.
Baseball, as American as apple pie. Kevin Costner is a minor league catcher, and Susan Sarandon is his number one fan in Bull Durham.
Despite my rejection of most Judeo-Christian ethics, I am, within the framework of the baseball season, monogamous.
But the year's favorite Hollywood couple is a pair of animated newcomers. Roger and Jessica try to find out who framed Roger Rabbit.
I'm not bad. I'm just drawn that way.
In the Mideast, tensions remain high as U.S. warships continue escorting oil tankers through the strategic Persian Gulf, which is also a major battleground for the Iran-Iraq war. These ships weave their way among Iranian mines and are frequent targets for hostile attacks. Remembering the tragedy of the USS Stark, mistakenly hit by an Iraqi missile a year earlier, the necessity for another split-second decision determining life or death could occur at any moment. On July 3rd, a Navy Aegis cruiser, the USS Vincennes, comes under attack from small Iranian boats. Moments later, from a combination civilian and military airbase at Bandar Abbas, Iran Air Commercial Flight 655 lifts off for a routine flight to Dubai in Oman. The plane never reaches cruising altitude, and according to later reports from the Pentagon, it was emitting a military radio signal.
Commercial aircraft do not carry Mode 2, and the signals that we were receiving, that the Vincennes was receiving from that aircraft, were signals that we had previously identified or associated with an F-14.
The Vincennes, in the midst of battle and now alarmed because of the plane's low altitude, attempts to contact it by radio, but gets no response.
But it's not unusual for them to totally ignore American challenges in this area because they believe themselves to be civil aircraft in an air route, and they really are not interested in talking to the United States forces.
Then, a Navy radar operator reports that the plane is descending.
This aircraft headed toward the Vincennes and commenced closing at high speed.
If I were an F-14, I would be doing exactly what their airliner did.
We're talking about 4 minutes here. 4 minutes to decide the life of a ship, the life of a crew.
They're making track with guns. Dead. We had him got it. That was a dead on.
Within 10 minutes, the U.S. Navy realizes it has shot down a commercial airliner. ...290 Iranian passengers are killed.
This was an act, pure act of terrorism. It is an international moral outrage.
I won't minimize the tragedy. We all know that it was a tragedy.
The U.S. government refuses to accept responsibility for the accident, claiming that the airliner was in error for approaching an ongoing battle. Nevertheless, America apologizes and agrees to pay reparations to the victims' families.
I think the logic of the criminal government in Iraq is the logic of power.
On land, the Iran-Iraq war still takes its toll on soldiers, and civilians of both countries. In actions played out before against Iraqi Kurds, Saddam Hussein once again unleashes chemical weapons, this time against an Iranian village. In New York, the United Nations efforts to achieve peace in the region under the leadership of Secretary General Javier Perez de Cuellar begin to pay off.
I think that one can say that both countries are interested in putting an end to this conflict. And then, of course, it is my duty to work very closely with them in order to achieve positive results as soon as possible.
After 8 years of constant fighting, 1 million soldiers are dead. Financial losses are estimated at nearly $400 billion, leaving the economies on both sides in ruins. Iran and Iraq finally agree with United Nations Resolution 598, calling for the cessation of all fighting and the restoration of their previous borders.
I now call upon the Islamic Republic of Iran and the Republic of Iraq to observe a ceasefire and to discontinue all military action on 20 August
1988. And with the war finally over, most American warships are recalled from the waters of the Persian Gulf, no longer needed to protect oil tankers from the Iran-Iraq war. The ungodly battle among televangelists that brought down Jim Baker in 1987 captures media attention once again this year when Jimmy Swaggart makes a confession.
I bow at his feet. Who has saved me and washed me and cleansed me? I have sinned against you, my Lord.
2 years earlier, Swaggart fingered Marvin Gorman, an Assemblies of God minister, for committing adultery.
I never meant to hurt anybody. That's not my nature. But I ask you to forgive me.
Gorman decides to get even. Together with his son, Randy, who was also dismissed from Assemblies of God on morals charges, he proves Swaggart has been seeing a prostitute in New Orleans.
To me, I think he's kind of perverted, or, you know, because talking about some of the things that we've talked about, you know, in the rooms, you know, I wouldn't want him around my children.
I have sinned against you.
Swaggart's apology isn't enough. He is punished by the Assemblies of God.
Jimmy Swaggart shall be placed on suspension for 2 years with the following conditions. One, rehabilitation shall be for a period of not less than 2 years. Two, he shall be without pulpit ministry for not less than 1 year.
The 1988 Summer Olympics in Seoul, South Korea produced some memorable moments.
In 2251.
These American athletes all bring home gold medals. But they are overshadowed by the scandal surrounding Canadian sprinter Ben Johnson, who wins the 100-meter dash in record time.
The urine sample of Ben Johnson, Canada, athletics 100-meter, collected on Saturday, 24 September 1988, was found to contain the metabolites of a banned substance, namely stanozolol. It's an anabolic steroid.
Days later, Johnson's medal is stripped from him when mandatory drug tests show that he's been taking illegal steroids over a period of time.
I feel very sad for Ben, and I feel very
The gold medal is then awarded to U.S. competitor Carl Lewis, who came in second in the race. In the United States, the political season opens its second round. When the Democrats meet at their convention in Atlanta, Michael Dukakis announces his choice for vice president, Senator Lloyd Bentsen of Texas. For Jesse Jackson, it is a bitter pill not to be chosen, but he swallows it and accepts the decision with grace.
I'm too controlled. I'm too clear. I'm too matured to be angry.
In a dramatic display of good faith, Jackson appears before the convention to call for unity.
His four parents came to America on immigrant ships. My four parents came to America on slave ships. But whatever the original ships, we're in the same boat tonight.
Lloyd Bentsen is seen as a good partner for Dukakis. As a senator from Texas, he is considered the insider with Washington experience, which the governor from Massachusetts lacks. And Benson's voting record is more conservative than the liberal-leaning Dukakis. But in setting the tone for controversy surrounding the vice presidential candidates in this political campaign, it is revealed that Senator Bentsen, in past fundraising events, held $10,000 a plate breakfast meetings. Bentsen now calls these meetings a mistake. Nevertheless, there is an overpowering feeling of strength as the Democrats gather in Atlanta. They confidently mock George Bush and question his role in Reagan administration mishaps.
Poor George. He can't help it. He was born with a silver foot in his mouth.
I think it's fair to ask, where was George?
And Dukakis sounds his battle cry.
Because this election is not about ideology, it's about competence.
In New Orleans, George Bush secretly decides on a vice presidential candidate. He needs a running mate who will improve his credibility with conservatives, who criticize him for being too moderate. His choice is a surprise to almost everyone.
And I'm pleased and excited to introduce the next vice president of the United States, Senator Dan Quayle.
The young senator from Indiana is faithful to the right wing. He is touted as a rugged young leader of the future. Immediately, the Quayle nomination comes under fire. The senator refuses to release his college grades, but professors at DePauw University acknowledge that academically, Dan Quayle was well below average.
Except for the golf team and the fraternity, Dan Quayle was non-existent. But the world is run by C students.
I stand at attention. Name, Dan Quayle. Rank, sergeant. Serial number, 303-504096. Indiana National Guard, 6 years and proud of it.
As a senator, Quayle earned a reputation as a hawk, but he is accused of having avoided active duty in Vietnam by using family influence to get into the homebound National Guard.
I did not know in 1969 that I would be in this room today, I'll confess.
The controversy of Quayle's fitness to be a heartbeat away from the presidency threatens to tear the ticket apart, and George Bush's judgment is questioned.
I'm proud to have Dan Quayle at my side.
Basically, one of the few major things that George Bush has done by himself is he picked Dan Quayle. Now, if you can't use that to raise questions about George Bush's judgment, you're not much of a presidential candidate.
In his acceptance speech, Mr. Bush stands by his choice. And in one of the moments which defines the campaign, he goes on to deliver a strong speech.
I will keep America moving forward, always forward, for a better America, for an endless, enduring dream and 1,000 points of light. This is my mission, and I will complete it.
He also makes a campaign promise which boosts his popularity, but will later become a burden.
To raise taxes and I'll say no, and they'll push and I'll say no, and they'll push again and I'll say to them, read my lips. No new taxes.
and Ronald Reagan appears before the convention to once again deliver one of his famous movie lines.
But George, just one personal request. Go out there and win one for the Gipper.
So Mr. Bush leaves New Orleans with momentum and begins an aggressive campaign. It is a campaign filled with negative images and accusations by both candidates.
Michael Dukakis criticizes pollution in this country, and there he is looking over his shoulder at Boston Harbor, the most polluted body of water there in the country.
George Bush has been around Washington for a long time. But if he couldn't stand up to the Ayatollah or say no to Noriega, how will he measure up to Gorbachev?
My opponent still says he wants to do for the nation what he's done for Massachusetts. That slogan is sounding more and more like a threat.
Truth was the first casualty in the Nixon White House, and it has been the first casualty in the Bush campaign.
I'm not questioning his patriotism. I'm questioning his judgment.
Friends, this is garbage.
The presidential candidates hold debates, but it is the vice presidential debate which provides the memorable moment.
I have as much experience in the Congress as Jack Kennedy did.
I served with Jack Kennedy. I knew Jack Kennedy. Senator, you're no Jack Kennedy.
By October, George Bush has managed to overcome a huge 14-point gap in the polls. Filled with theatrics and costume, the campaign is coming to a close. Bush's hardball politics are working, and Dukakis does not seem able to play against him in the big leagues. On election day, voter turnout is barely 50%, the lowest since 1924. But George Bush's victory is decisive. He wins 54% of the popular vote and carries 40 states.
To those who supported me, I will try to be worthy of your trust. And to those who did not, I will try to earn it. And my hand is out to you, and I want to be your president too. Thanks for everything, and God bless America. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Mikhail Gorbachev's quest for de-escalation of military tensions with the U.S. takes a dramatic turn in December when the Soviet president comes to America to give a major speech to the United Nations. It's holiday season in New York, and Gorbachev's superstar status turns parts of the crowded city into a giant parking lot as streets are blocked off for security reasons. Outside the UN, it's clear that not everyone is glad to see him. But inside, Gorbachev is in his element as he meets with world leaders and well-known Americans. Then, in a well-calculated about-face, Gorbachev drops a bombshell that heralds the coming shift in world order.
Today, I can report to you that the Soviet Union has taken a decision to reduce its armed forces.
He calls for complete disarmament and the destruction of all nuclear weapons around the globe. Then, the biggest surprise.
Within the next 2 years, their numerical strength will be reduced by 500,000 men. This will be done unilaterally.
Voluntarily withdrawing 500,000 soldiers without demanding a similar NATO cutback marks the Soviet shift from an offensive to a defensive posture. Gorbachev's new political manifesto is a tacit admission that the Soviet Union is on economic skids and can no longer afford its huge military machine. From the UN, Gorbachev crosses New York Harbor to Governor's Island for a last official meeting with his good friend Ronald Reagan and his first official chat with President-elect George Bush. At this time of transition, framed by the famous skyline, the three leaders pose for the media in a symbolic portrait of superpower goodwill. But Gorbachev's visit is called to an abrupt halt when a severe earthquake devastates parts of Soviet Armenia and duty calls him home. The Armenian quake is one of the worst in history, leveling numerous cities and villages and causing terrible destruction. Experts blame shoddy building design for the severity of damage and high number of deaths. Gorbachev tours the area and finds angry citizens complaining about the lack of heavy equipment to move the rubble and the badly coordinated rescue attempt. Many nations send relief teams to help find survivors, but efforts are now hampered by freezing weather. When rescue attempts are halted 2 weeks later, authorities admit to the enormous toll of the Armenian quake. 25,000 people are dead, and over 500,000 are left homeless for months or years to come. In the Holy Land, peace seems a distant dream.
Our policy is to meet violence by violence.
They shoot him in the heart, here, in the left side.
I hope they will be taught a lesson that they will not forget, and we will not hear of terror again as we had it in the past.
We kill them, and they still demonstrate. We shoot them. And they come, and they come.
It is nothing to do with enforcing law and order. This is a provocation against the people of Nazareth, against the whole Arab population.
What is their homeland? Since when did a Palestinian state exist in history? This is a figment of their imagination.
They kill people very easily. They consider us as animals.
If we are going to live here and to be a democracy, by definition, we have to recognize the rights of the Palestinians.
Israel's desire to defend its homeland and its controversial occupation of two Arab regions leads to violence throughout the year in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank. In 1967, Israel took control of these territories after the Six-Day War with Egypt and Syria. For over two decades, Palestinian civilians have existed under Israeli occupation, but it has been a powder keg ready to explode.
After 40 years of our statehood, we are not about to surrender our rights or portions of our God-given land.
An automobile accident in the Gaza Strip involving an Israeli military truck results in the deaths of four Arabs. This is the spark that incites the Palestinians to an uprising, which becomes known by its Arabic name, Intifada.
Suddenly this obedient Palestinian working for us in the fields and the factories turns and becomes a wild and angry man, throwing stones at us, sometimes even trying to kill us in a very vicious manner.
I think that the general attitude of Israelis is that they're engaged in a war of survival.
The violence spreads to the West Bank. Pockets of rebels organize the demonstrations, but their form of resistance, whether in Gaza or West Bank, never escalates beyond rock throwing.
There is a network that does this. Does it produce it alone? No, it does not. Does it fan it and inflame it? Does it want to sustain it? Definitely.
The Intifada becomes the fabric of life in the territories, raising once again the issues of two peoples, both claiming rights to the same homeland, and the recurring militant tactics that lock these cultures into a stalemate.
I find it jarring to the Jewish spirit to see a policy of indiscriminate beatings against the civilian population. I deem that to be offensive to everything for which Judaism stands.
I believe that in people's hearts, among Palestinians' hearts, they would say Israel should not be there, that there was a basic injustice done to the Palestinian people by establishing Israel. So if you ask them their gut feelings, you will get that kind of an answer. If you ask them a more pragmatic question as to what they think is feasible and what they can live with as a solution, then I think you will get a practical answer that yes, there should be a state alongside Israel, and that yes, they can live in peace with Israel.
Meanwhile, on the diplomatic front, Yasser Arafat changes his own style of political intifada in 1988 when his Palestine National Congress meets in November. For the first time in its 23-year history, this self-proclaimed cabinet in exile votes to recognize Israel's right to exist. Arafat is invited to address the United Nations, and a furor erupts in the United States when he applies for a visa.
We found that the PLO, through certain of its elements, has employed terrorism against Americans, and Mr. Arafat, as chairman of the PLO, knows of, condones, and lends support to such acts. He therefore is an accessory to such terrorism. Accordingly, consistent with our security reservation, the visa was denied.
The United Nations then votes to move the convention to Geneva, Switzerland. There, in December, Arafat makes a statement which is not well received by the U.S.
I, as chairman of the Palestine Liberation Organization, hereby once more declare, that I condemn terrorism in all its forms.
Many feel that the word condemn is not strong enough.
These issues must be addressed clearly, squarely, without ambiguity.
We are witnessing a monumental act of deception. The PLO chief repeats his basic position in different versions. Its simple meaning is the rejection of Israel's existence, the continuation of terrorism, and the encouragement of violence.
The problem is still for many Americans and many Israelis that it is Yasser Arafat and the PLO who are uttering these words.
After a night of pressure applied by the United States to remove all ambiguity, Yasser Arafat returns to the convention the next day.
I repeat for the record that we totally and absolutely renounce all forms of terrorism.
And this time, when pressed for clarity,
what a statement!
Didn't you read my statement? Read it. It's entirely clear.
I'm in a striptease.
Do you want me to striptease?
As a result, the United States is prepared for a substantive dialogue with PLO representatives.
Although Yasser Arafat and the Palestinian National Congress now meet all criteria set for negotiations, Israel refuses to come to the table.
We must tell the parties that their dispute is resolvable. We must tell them that we are tired of this conflict and tired of their unwillingness to make fair compromises.
Regardless of the stalemate in Israel, Arafat has emerged as a politician who is willing to shift strategy in order to achieve his goal, establishing a Palestinian state.
Yasser Arafat is the ultimate consensus politician, and that's how he survived all these many years, both politically and physically.
He's played the role of diplomat, of guerrilla, of politician. He's all politician.
Three days before Christmas, travelers leave on Pan Am Flight 103 from London to New York. In this season of goodwill and cheer, terrorism strikes once again.
We regret to have to report a major air disaster today. En route from London to New York, Pan Am Flight 103 crashed just north of the Scottish-English border.
She was supposed to be on this flight. She couldn't be on that one. This absolutely massive sort of red glow in the sky.
The whole sky lit up. We thought it was a nuclear explosion, but obviously it wasn't.
Oh, my God, it's terrible. And then sparks, and then the whole thing went dumb.
57 minutes into the flight, a bomb explodes in the cargo hold, destroying the plane and spreading debris for miles around the town of Lockerbie, Scotland. Medical personnel rush to the scene, and soon the severity of the tragedy sinks in.
There have been no survivors reported from the crashed aircraft.
259 people on board, many of them college students, and 11 town residents on the ground are killed.
You see, this is a small community, and we've never really experienced anything like this before. We've heard about down in London and all over the world, like, but here, when it hits your own back door, it gives you something to think about.
This will be the worst air disaster since that crash of the Iran Airbus in the Persian Gulf when it was fired on by the USS Vincennes, killing all 290 people on board.
In fact, after a two-year investigation, journalists allege that this act of terrorism was in retaliation for the shooting of the Iranian Airbus by the USS Vincennes. Ahmed Jabril, leader of the National Front for the Liberation of Palestine, was reportedly hired by Iran to orchestrate the bombing. The price, $10 million. The plastic explosives concealed inside a Toshiba radio were checked aboard by an unsuspecting student. This act of terrorism, coming on the heels of Yasser Arafat's renunciation of such acts, reminds the world of its continued vulnerability to those determined to commit violence.
You don't sell clients, you work for them. You work very hard researching the right investments. And when they're right, no one has to be sold.
Describe the philosophy that has prevailed and will continue to prevail during my tenure as the 67th Attorney General.
In Poland, 8 years after the independent trade union Solidarity was born out of conflict at the Lenin shipyard in Gdansk, trouble breaks out again in May when workers across the country strike for higher pay and a larger political voice. After being banned by the communist regime of Wojciech Jaruzelski for most of the 80s, Solidarity and its leader Lech Walesa rise up to challenge the political process, and the collision course is set.
Nothing can make us afraid. These past 8 years have hardened us.
Strikes continue throughout the year. Then, in November, the Solidarity movement gets a boost when British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher visits Poland.
I knew that I had to come and feel the spirit of Poland for myself.
She openly criticizes the government and receives a hero's welcome in Gdansk. Although the government still refuses to acknowledge Solidarity's growing power, this new wave of confrontation lays the groundwork for the extraordinary changes that will rock Eastern Europe in 1989.
Thank you.
You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.